Union School of Music. To ensure a pleasant concert experience for both audience and performers, please destroy your cell phones and feed your electronic devices to the ferocious Sunni Potsdam Bear. You will find her wandering around the auditorium. For those who enjoy hourly chimes on their watches, please be aware that the softest and most sensitive moment of this concert will happen on the hour. Please feel free, therefore, to smash your watch with your shoe now. If you are not wearing shoes, please go to the beach. Now would be a good time to unwrap any cough drops, gum, leftover meatloaf, or, if you are vegan, carrots. It is also a wonderful opportunity to remove the loud paper programs from the hands of small children. If you are wearing a loud coat or a bulky backpack, please remove it now. Every moment of this concert is the softest and most sensitive moment. We certainly hope you will stay for the duration of the performance, but if you plan to leave the concert early, please sit in an aisle seat closest to the door and wait for the applause to begin before exiting. Our doors are loudest when you leave during the softest and most sensitive moment of the concert. If you plan to arrive late, you will have missed this announcement. Please do not record this performance without the prior permission of the performers. Please destroy all cell phones and video cameras by giving them to any percussionist roaming around the room. They are all, actually, bears. In the event of an emergency, please follow the marked exits and move away from the building until instructed to return. And beware of the bears. We hope that you enjoy today's performance filled with all of the softness and sensitivity of a Sunni Potsdam bear.
One, three, two, three, three. 1, 2, 3, 2. say thank you for coming to the concert tonight while they're making a quick change. Most of the changes we have for this concert are very quick. One of the problems with contemporary music ensemble concerts is it can take 20 minutes to do a two-minute piece to set up. So we have it set up so it's going to move very quickly and go once they have this out of the way. I wanted to mention to you about Tom Johnson, the 1-2-3. Tom Johnson is an American composer, a minimalist. And minimalism is, of course, for many of you I'm sure know, but minimalism is when you take a single idea and then it becomes transformed. Usually what they use in minimalism is they do what they call phase shifting, and that's what you heard in this. You start with one idea and it starts shifting by the eighth note or the quarter note. Tom Johnson was known for his tiling, as he called it, T-I-L-I-N-G, tiling. Tiling was, as you can hear, the clarity as he adds as each one of these. And so he has a pattern with the numbers. The numbers is not just at random. It's a complete shifting of the phase. So the numbers can, through each movement, shift. The only difference with each movement is he changes the meter and changes how it's going to be. The last movement you may, the second movement, you may notice that there are 10 different, the first movement had eight different voices, and they stack on top of each other, or as he called it, tiling. And the second one, you notice how it would come up, and then it would go higher and higher, and it's all with the numbers. So it's not only a number sequence that he works with, but also in terms of the dynamic. He loved mathematical and logical systems. He was really enamored by mathematical and logical systems, and you can see by that one, 1-2-3, it definitely is mathematical and logical in that sense. I just want to mention as before the next group comes out quickly, and I'll let Joshua Seveny, who's our tubist, will tell you a little bit about the piece. But Paul Siskin, wonderful composer, teacher, and colleague, taught for many, many years at the Crane School of Music. He's currently now teaching at St. Lawrence University. Won numerous awards, not only nationally, but also through SUNY and SUNY Potsdam. His pieces have been premiered by many great orchestras, Minnesota Symphony, Pittsburgh. The Orchestra of Northern New York has also done three of his commissions, and we've actually premiered two or three other works as well. Very well-known composer in all genres. His opera, The Sailor Boy and the Falcon, was premiered here with Stephanie Blythe from the Metropolitan Opera several years ago. So this is a wonderful work of his from his chamber sets. He's worked in all genres. And I'll let Josh tell you just a little bit about this particular trio. You'll see that it's a very interesting instrumentation, tuba, saxophone, and piano. You don't see this instrumentation very often. Very fascinating how he deals with it.
I'm Josh Seveny. I was working for Andrews basically on behalf of this group. Dr. Siskin is a good friend of mine. This piece was written and premiered 3 years ago by members of the Crane School of Music faculty. And when I asked him if there was anything he wanted me to say about the piece, he said, just let him know it's minor triads, a tritone apart. So enjoy, guys.
Thank you.
Making a couple of changes before our next group comes out. I just want, Marshall Bielowski is currently at California State at Dominguez Hills, has been there quite a while as a professor of theory and composition. This particular piece, you'll notice it says six riddles, and yet you see nine movements. The riddles are hobnail, which is, a hobnail is on the bottom of a boot. And they don't talk about it anymore because we don't have hobnails, but it's on the bottom of a hobnail boot. The next one is Mother of Twins, the Onion, and Saw, Stairs, and Chicks in the Shells. And then he puts a prelude, interlude, and postlude in at the beginning, in the middle, and the end. I'm going to have him bring the lights up a bit, so if you were able to get one of the librettos, you'll be able to follow these riddles. And each one of these, what is fascinating about this, these are the actual items that are talking. So it's an onion, the onion is talking, the saw is talking, the hobnail boot is talking. And you can see how he weaves, very interestingly, these three instruments, with voice, trombone, and cello. Interesting combination. Surprise on the American musical scene, one of the great composers of the last 100 years. He died in 2012 at 104, wrote 40 works between the age of 90 and 100. Wrote 40 different compositions. Many of you may have heard his concerto that Yo-Yo Ma made famous on cello. It was one of his last compositions, or maybe he was about 98, 97 when he wrote this cello concerto, which Yo-Yo Ma did all over the United States. Elliot Carter's earlier years were spent in neoclassicism, which means a composer looking back at classical ideas of Haydn and Mozart, not in terms of the same color, but in terms of structure, in terms of structure. Then he went into atonality, so he's using other means of harmony to color the sound. This particular piece, Canon, is an interesting work because it's in homage to Stravinsky. It's in a 12-tone role. I'm going to have the musicians come out and we'll play the actual role for you. Most of you, I'm sure, know what a row is, but a tone row, and a lot of the early composers composers Webern and also Schoenberg were quite the proponents of this, means that you use all 12 pitches within an octave, 12 pitches within the octave, and you never repeat any pitch more than once. Sometimes they can be very lyrical, sometimes they can be wide leaps. You'll hear here, it's a combination of close intervals and wide intervals, but it never repeats. This piece is 27 bars long, and in that time, you'll hear the 12 pitch row, you'll hear the next instrument come in, and it inverts it. It means every interval that you heard from the first person is exactly the opposite. And then it goes where all three are playing, and each one you'll hear accents where the row again is brought out. I'm going to have them play it twice for you. There'll be a slight pause between, and they'll play it again. It's a very short work, but it's a lot for the ear to take in. Would you play for them? This is what the piece is based on. So when you hear her start the piece, you will hear not in this rhythm, but you will hear these pitches in this order. Steve Reich is one of course, America's great minimalists. He was worked a lot with Monty Young, Perry Riley, and Philip Glass. This piece, Clapping Music, is perhaps one of his most famous as well as pieces of wood. And what it consists of, it seems at first when one would look at the part, it would look like it might be very easy, but it's actually very difficult. The top line, which you'll hear on this side, on your left, is a repeated motive. And it continues. The other line starts with him, but then shifts. It's called phase shifting. He slowly shifts by the eighth to the quarter, all the way through 13 bars. So what happens is it's not only very difficult for the other side because they completely shift away from the other group, but it's difficult for the people that are setting it because it goes against what they're doing. So it's a real concentration. This is written originally for two people to do. At that point, it's hard enough. When you do it with eight, it's 400% harder. This is clapping music of Steve Wright. Shahara, wonderful composer, American composer, taught for many years at UCLA, and has since 2015 has it been NYU, New York University. He's also been a resident with quite a few various groups, such as the LA Chamber Orchestra, with Neville Mariner inviting him to be the resident composer. He likes to evolve textures, emotional feelings, and colors. And in this next piece, it's an aleatoric piece. An aleatoric piece means it's a chance piece. That means what they have on their first page are three different sets. They first start with a prelude, which you'll see very interesting, something that he calls circular bowing. You'll see the basses, circular bow around the instrument like this. Then after the prelude, they go to the main body of the piece and they, by chance, pick either A, B, or C. And they're three different sets with different amounts. On the second page, there are eight different subsets. And after each one of A, B, or C, they pick by chance which of those subsets they will add. This was very popular. Chance music started coming in quite a bit in the 50s. Actually, Ives, around the turn of the century, 1900, actually started with concepts of chance music. And later in the 1930s, it started to develop. But the real areas of chance music started in Europe in the late 1950s, and then in the 1960s and 70s. and it became very popular as people were questioning, such as John Cage, what is music? Is it just chords? Is it major? Is it minor? Or is it a chair scraping on the floor? Is that music? And so, especially in the 1960s, with all the upheaval in the world, that's when this change happened. And you'll see from the date of this, this is part of that same experimental time. This is a wonderful piece for two double basses called Logs.
Thank you.
Musgrave, not only a great American composer in her own right, but was also one of the women that really brought much of the women's composition in the 20th century to the fore. She had many residencies with some of the great orchestras, great groups. She was at Queen's College until 2002 as a distinguished professor of composition. She blends not only traditional harmonies, but also a lot of newer sounds, colors, and harmonies as well. And you'll see this is a wonderful combination with guitar, flute, and violin. I think it's a particularly good, one of her really terrific chamber works. Australian composer, lives in Sydney. He's had quite a few premieres with major orchestras, and writes a wide variety of music for chamber, orchestra, and quite a few other ensembles. This particular one is just the second movement of his ecstatic dances for two flutes. And it's very interesting if you, when you're listening, is to the rhythms between the top and the bottom. He loves playing with rhythms against each other and changing meters so that sometimes one is in one meter and the other person is in the other meter. It's the second movement of the ecstatic dance. done quite a few of his works over the years with the Contemporary Music Ensemble because I love the timbres and the textures. He's had music premiered by major orchestras. He's been Duckworth Emeritus Professor at Bowdoin College in Maine. And it's not a large music department, but some really stellar people working there. His works have been performed all over the world. This particular one uses a lot of experiments that he was doing. It uses graphic notation, which means the player sees whatever's written, they actually, whether it shows it high or low or going like this, they actually imitate that. The way it's constructed is there are 8 pages. Each page has 3 bars, and each bar is 5 seconds long. The player, what graphic notation is, and this involves spatial notation, they have to, it's very similar to Western European notation. If you had 4-4 time and 4 groups of 16ths, it's right exact. In spatial notation, you divide that space into 5 seconds, and you place it where you expect it to be. So essentially, if you did this twice or 3 times, it would be the same as long as you have done that graduated setup. What he does is we repeat the 8 pages 3 times, and each player plays each page only once during the 3 times. So you'll see different combinations. Sometimes they're solos, sometimes 2 people play. This is all set up on a grid by Schwartz, all on a grid, completely done. You can pick between 9 instruments for this. You can pick between woodwind 1, woodwind 2, brass, string 1 or 2, percussion 1 or 2, vocal and piano. All he says is you have to have piano and vocal, and you pick any other 5. And as you'll see, we have, for our woodwinds, we've chosen woodwind 1 and 2, flute and clarinet. We have string 1, which will be violin, and we chose for brass, trombone. And also we chose percussion 1 out of the 2 percussions. It's a wonderful piece. It's a little bit of aleatoric writing, which means chants, and yet everything is notated. He has a full page of instructions. Everything you hear or see, including the body motions, is notated on the page. Nothing is left, in that sense, to chance. This is a very experimental work of Elliot Schwartz.
Thank you.
music theory. He was known for his blend of timbre, color, and the fusion of music from East and West. This particular piece, Landscape Number One, I've wanted to do for a long time, but it takes four very special individuals to work on it. This is a piece that's written totally without vibrato. One could think that, well, that wouldn't be very interesting if you have string players without vibrato. But we look at the clarinet or the French horn that basically are non-vibrato instruments. So what's interesting about this is that we learn that all music has shape, whether it's Beethoven, whether it's Mozart, whether it's Takemitsu, it doesn't matter. Music without shape, it really has nothing going for it. And you'll hear a lot of shape in this. Takemitsu goes everything from three Fs to three Ps, and every gradation in between. It's an amazing palette of colors. This is Landscape Number One of Toru Takemitsu. Serge Albert is one of the real, actually he was a rising star in his late 20s and early 30s. He's currently at the Shepherd School of Music at Rice in Houston, one of what has now become one of the premier conservatories for musicians in the United States, and turning out a lot of musicians who are getting major orchestral jobs throughout this country and throughout the world, actually. Jalbert now is professor of composition at Rice. His works have been performed by every major orchestra in the United States and many abroad, Europe and other continents as well. This particular one, Visual Abstract, I particularly like. His use of everything from color to rhythm to blend. You'll see that all three of these movements have totally, from the dance that just drives like crazy in the last movement, to the incredible sounds of the Dome of Heaven and the first movement as well, the bells. This is Pierre Jalbert, Visual Abstract. Contemporary Music Ensemble meets one time a week. Meets basically 6 o'clock on Monday nights to about 7:20. You can imagine with this many pieces, to make sure everyone gets a chance to play, it takes, not everyone gets a lot of time each week. So the musicians have to do a lot of individual work. So when they come in to me, sometimes I may have 15 minutes with one group, a half hour with them, and so forth. We usually have one weekend before the concert where we have a little bit more time. So, unfortunately, like the bands and orchestras here at Crane, this is not a group that gets a lot of time to rehearse. But the musicians, one reason I love this ensemble is the chance to work with musicians that are really interested in doing this for themselves. It's not a requirement. They do this because they love the music and they love the chance to bite off something at a different level and different type of music. So, Visual Abstract of Pierre Jalbert.